universal families of hash functions, and then we will see how what we can do with them. By the way, when it comes to randomized hashing, I got an important question. You see, once for the run of the program, once you pick your random hash function, you freeze it for the life of hash table, right? So whatever you have to do until you need, for as long as you need that particular hash table, you keep the same hash function, but each time you call this program, you run this program, it picks the hash function at random, right? But of course, you have to keep frozen the hash function for the life of the table. Okay, so this is an important property of hash functions. So if you, in general, when we do randomized hashing, we will be picking functions from some collection, right? Well, such a finite collection of hash functions that maps all your keys into a much smaller range from 0 to m minus 1 is universal if for any two pairs of keys, the total number of functions which collide them is precisely h divided by the size of the slot, right? So for any two keys, 1 over m of the totality of all hash functions will collide these two elements, okay? We will see later how we build. Now, what does this mean? If for any two keys, x and y, if you randomly pick hash function from h, the chance of a collision is then exactly 1 over m, right? Because you have cardinality of h, many functions all together, and this many collide, so the probability to pick one that will collide is exactly 1 over m. So how do we use this property? So the trick is kind of counting the number of collisions. So whenever we have to count things, we will deal ultimately with probabilities, right? Well, probabilities are, of course, can be, as we will see, estimated through expected values. So you have for any two keys, y and z, you can define a random variable which, when you pick the hash function and you hash y and z, its value is 1 if y and z collide, and otherwise it is 0, right? So if you then fix x, then by definition of a universal family, let's compute the expected or the average value of cyx. Well, average value or expected value is we have only two different outcomes, 1 and 0. Probability that the outcome is 1, namely that collision did happen, is probability to pick a hash function that collides the two keys. But that's precisely 1 over m. So it's 1 over m, this probability, times 1. Probability that it's not collided, of course, is 1 minus m, but the value is 0, so we get just 1 over m. So if you fix x, then all of these random variables they have expected value 1 over m. Now, we want to use this to estimate the total number of collisions with x, right? Now, that's easy by additivity of expectation. So let's denote by cx the total number of collisions involving key x. What is this? Well, c of x is simply sum of all these random variables when y is not equal to x. Notice x is fixed, right? So here the index of summation is y. I should have put here y, comma, y not equal to x to make it clear that summation goes only over y. So what is the expected value of the number of collisions? Well, the expected value is simply the sum of expected values of these guys. But by additivity of expectation, we know that this is then the sum of expected values of these guys, but they all have the same expectation, 1 over m, right? And we have n minus 1. So n is the number of keys that you are hashing. M is the number of slots in the table, right? So the sum of these expected values is n minus 1 over n. Now, important consequence is that if you are hashing fewer or equal number of keys than what you have number of slots, then the expected total number of collisions involving any particular key x is less than 1. So this means that if you look at any key, you look in what slot it sits, there will be on average less than 1 collision. So it will be most of the time collision free or very few collisions, because the expected value for every non-empty slot is less than one collision. So obviously, universal family is a family that kind of tries to, on average, minimize the total number of collisions in the table. This is why we like them, right? Okay, so the conclusion is that if we choose randomly a hash function from universal family of functions, h, and we hash n keys into a table of size m, then the expected number of keys in each slot is n over m, which if n is smaller than the size or equal the size of the hash table, is strictly smaller than 1. So the expected value of collisions per slot is strictly smaller than 1. Okay, so how do we design a universal family of hash functions? So we have to kind of now make a detour. Maybe it was better if I showed you how you use universal family, but just trust me at the moment that this is a useful concept. So let's first see how to produce such a family. So we choose for the size of m of the hash table to be a prime number. Now, in the construction that I'm going to show you, it's important that m is prime, but there is a slight version of this algorithm that doesn't require m to be prime. Even though, you know, primeness is not a terrible limitation, because between any n and 2n, there is always at least 1 prime. That's a brilliant theorem by Chebyshev from, when is it, mid-19th century. So between n and 2n, there is always a prime number. So if you need the size of the table to be prime, you want double your minimal size that you would like to have if you take it prime. So this is not limiting. Okay, so then what do we do? So the size of the key, yeah. You wanted to ask something? No? Okay. You were just stretching? Maybe that's a good idea. let R be the size of the entire universe. And so what's the idea with hashing? You want to put things into, keys with huge range in much smaller table, right? So what do you do then? Well, you choose R so that R is the floor of log m of u. So you see, log, so m will be a quite a large number in general. You take a prime that is kind of not too large so that you don't risk overflows when you do calculations, but it's kind of close to the, you know, relatively close to the maximal size that can fit in your register. So m is rather large, so log m of u will be a small number, right? So this r will be a small number, and if it's equal to the floor of log m of u, then it's easy to see, right, that's equivalent of saying this is that the universe u is m to the power r. And it is smaller than m to the power of r plus 1. So you can see that the universe of the keys is much larger than the size of the table. So now we do the following. This is an extremely important trick, right? And you saw it already when I gave you this homework, the business with the radix sort. If you think of this M as the basis of a representation, right, of numbers, right, then if u is smaller than m to the r plus 1, any key can be represented. Essentially, this is the representation of the key in basis m. Do you say basis or base? Base. When will I learn English eventually? You see, both Americans, I spent 17 years in America and then in Australia. The trouble with both America and Australia is that both Americans and Australians are extremely tolerant of foreigners kind of speaking strange version of English, right? In fact, I remember when I was a student at Berkeley and I had a wonderful landlady that was 94 years old. She was mother of a very famous cellist, American cellist, Bonnie Hampton. Anyhow, so she was so nice to me that once I decided to buy her some flowers, right? And so I went to this flower shop and asked the lady that was working there if I can get these flowers. And she told me, oh, you have such a wonderful thick accent. And I was, let me parse this. It's wonderful thick accent. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is a good news for lazy foreigners like myself. Okay, so base M. We represent X in the base M. And lo and behold, then all the digits are smaller between 0 and m. And this means that every key can be represented as a tuple. So this is now we are vectorizing the keys. Each key is a tuple. And now these guys can be kept relatively small, namely m. Because we will the expressive power you can index with this m to the r, so much larger number of elements. So once you vectorize your input, then you do the following trick. And this is like in databases and in internet searches, and it's just for just incredibly important trick. So then you define your hash function as the value of the scalar product of your key with a randomly chosen sequence. Oh, sorry, this is A's, and these are, I'm confusing them with X's. So X will be now replaced. I should have written it here. X is then replaced by its quote-unquote coordinates, namely the digits, right? So X will be equal to X0, X1, up to XR, okay? Now what you do is you choose randomly a vector from the same space, so from the space of all tuples, so that these guys, all coordinates are smaller than m. Just choose them at randomly. And then define the corresponding hash function to be this expression mod m, just this expression by itself. You should have known by now, after the whole business with FFT, what does it represent? Yes, say it louder. The dot product. So each key is mapped into its coordinates, right? Simply digits in base m. You choose A to be a random vector, A R, and then you simply find dot product of AX and you mod it out by M. Right? So H of X is simply the dot product mod M. Because of all this business with multimedia, dot product is computable lightning fast, because usually computers have these multiply add things that are used for to compute convolutions and whatever you need for signal and image processing. So this guy is actually computable extremely fast, and you just mod it out with them, and this is this is your hash value. Now, for what we are going to do now, we do not need what I'm going to tell you now, but in principle, you can choose randomly several of such vectors, and then consider a super hash function. Say you choose k many of them, and then the hash function is a tuple, k tuple of these values. This works extremely well because this very strange property of high-dimensional space, namely, if you have lots of coordinates, right, then, and you choose vectors at random, they are almost orthogonal with very large probability. Any two vectors randomly chosen are likely to be orthogonal, so you get, without doing any work, you get an almost orthogonal coordinate system for these vectors, because if you choose two vectors at random, they are almost orthogonal. And that's used just in incredibly many database constructions. Because you reduce dimensionality, you know, if you have, say, five of these functions, then, and this is, you know, say, 100 coordinate here, then you reduce 100 space of this dimensionality 100 to just dimensions five dimensions, and then it's much easier to deal with that. And because this business that the randomly chosen vectors are almost with high probability almost orthogonal, plays a crucial role. Okay, so now let's see why such obtained family of hash functions, why it is universal. So what is the family? The family of hash functions is essentially just the family of all tuples, right? Every tuple will produce a hash function, every tuple A. So we want to show that then hash functions that correspond to the tuples form a universal family. And that's a very neat and simple proof. This is how you do it. Assume that you do have, so what do we have to show in order to prove that it's universal? We have to show that whenever you pick two keys, right, and then any two keys, x and y, and then randomly pick a hash function, probability of collision is precisely 1 over n, right? How do we do that? Well, let's see what it means that these two, that x and y collided. This would mean that This, what have I written here? Ah, yes, that this sum is equal to that sum mod m, right? Meaning that mod m of this is equal to mod m of that. But this is just basic properties of the mod function. This is equivalent to saying that this minus this is congruent to zero mod m. And then you can pull out a's, right, and have this expression equal to zero, right? Now, because x and y are two distinct keys, at least one of the corresponding coordinates will be distinct. So, and without loss of generality, because it works exactly the same for any coordinate, we will assume that x0 is different from y0. And lo and behold, then we have the following. I keep one of, so only x0 minus y0 times a0 on this side of equation, and all other factors I move to the other side. So I get that x0 minus y0 times a0 is equal to this mod m, right? Now we use the fact that the remainders modulo a prime form a multiplicative group, which means that all of these factors, non-zero factors, this any value here has a multiplicative inverse, right? Because that's true for if m is prime, every number is invertible product. For any number z in 0 to m, there exists a number which we call z to the minus 1, which is just another number from this set, so that the product is equal to 1 mod m. So what does this entail? It entails that this, because we assume this is non-zero, we can divide, we can multiply with the inverse of this, which is essentially kind of division, right? And you get that this is equal to this times the inverse of this, whatever it happens to be, the element of the table, mod n. But what does this mean? It means if I choose randomly all a's from 1 to m, there will be only one, from 1 to r, there will be always, for every choice of all other i's from 1 to r, there will be only one value for which will cause a collision, namely a0, that is given by this formula. So this means that I look at my hash functions, right? They are represented by r tuples, randomly chosen tuples of elements between 0 and m minus 1. If I choose r minus 1 many of them, or how many I did put here, it's r plus 1 altogether. So if I choose just r many of them, arbitrarily, for any arbitrary choice of r many of them, there will be only one choice for the first entry that will collide. And now we are done. Why? Because how many choices do we have of tuples, right? Altogether, from A1 to AR, of course, we have m to the r tuples, right? So for every tuple of this, there is only one guy here. So this is number of functions that will cause a collision. And this is total number of tuples, so total number of functions. And clearly, when you cancel out m to the r, you get 1 over m. So simply for arbitrary choice from A1 to AR, there is only one choice for A0 that will cause a collision. So the number of functions that cause the collision will be precisely number of R tuples, but the total number of functions is number of R plus one many tuples. So if you divide number of tuples that causes the collision with the number, total number of tuples, you get the fraction precisely 1 over m, which is what universal hash function family is. You have questions? Are you following this?
Maybe.
What is the tricky part? I would like to... Okay, next time no flowers. Better give me some salad, it's edible. Okay, so what do we have here? So remember, just hash functions are represented as sequences or R plus of tuples of length R plus one. We showed for every choice of the last R, every R tuple of the last R elements, there is only one choice for the first element. So the total number of functions that cause collision is m to the r, total number of functions m to the r plus 1, so it's 1 over m. Okay, so now, this is, yes? Sorry? Okay, so this is how the hash function is designed. Okay, so you take there was a marker here, but what did I do with it? So you have a universe U of all keys, which is very large, okay? You take a much smaller number M that will be the size. So assume that, you know, the total universe of keys is are all Z numbers of all students, right? It's a very large set, and I want to do some fast searching, right? So I can choose a much smaller number than U, namely I can, or the cardinality of U. So I take R to be log m of the cardinality of U, right? So then what do I know? Then m to the r is bigger or equal than the size of the universe. So the size of the universe is, so the size of the universe is bigger or equal than m to the r, but it is smaller than m to the r plus 1. This means that any key can be represented in base m with at most r plus 1 digits. So now the value of the key can be very large, but we replace it with the sequence of digits in base m, right? So this will be now much smaller because these are all smaller than m, smaller than the size of the hash table, so it's manageable. And you have certain number of coordinates, whatever many you need in order to exceed the cardinality of the keys, right? So every key is replaced by a vector. Then what you do to generate hash functions is you randomly choose numbers between 0 and m minus 1, r many of them. So you pick randomly such vectors. And your function, hash function, is then defined as the scalar product of these two vectors mod m, right? So now we want to show that such family of functions, so each function is given by this expression, so essentially the functions are indexed by these random tuples. Now, we want to show that this family of functions is universal. Why is this so? Well, we show that I can choose this in how many? M to the r many ways. And for whenever I choose m to the r, for any pair of keys, this guy will be uniquely determined by the formula that we saw before, which is, here is the formula. This says what a zero has to be equal in order to have a collision, right? So the total number of hash functions that will collide x and y is m to the r, right? Because for any choice here, you are determined, it's automatically determined what this has to be to have a collision. But total number of all tuples is m to the r plus 1. So out of m to the r plus 1 many hash functions, m to the r will collide. So then what is that fraction? Well, it's m to the r divided by m to the r plus 1, thus 1 over m. Yeah. So read, I guess this is all non-trivial stuff, but it's not a rocket science. If you have any questions, just come to my office hours and I'll be more than happy to help you. Okay, so now what we want to do is we want to make a good use of universal family, and our goal is to obtain something called perfect hashing. So let's look at that now. Full screen. Okay. Yeah, so please read these slides, try to understand every line, and if you have questions, come to ask me during my office hours. So now we want to show first how we use universal hash functions, what they are good for. We saw that when we use them to hash the keys, we get tables that have that probability, that expected number of collisions is less than 1. So things will be nicely, in all likelihood, there will be uniformly distributed keys, which is what you want from a hash function. But now we want to add another ingredient. We want to get something called perfect hashing. So assume that you have n keys, and you want to hash them in a table that is not much larger in size than n. It's linear in n, so that there are absolutely no collisions. And this will be, of course, a static table. This is how you build good lookup tables, right? So the size of the table should be small. Now, one would wonder if we have n keys, right? Why would you need a hash table of size larger than n to make it collision-free? Well, you see, you have no control what the keys are. Right? And the hash function has to be easily and uniformly computable. So it has to be really fast computable and must not cause any collision, right? So how would you do it? Just imagine you have a bunch of long keys and you have to put them in table. It's totally unclear in what slot to put them so that the computation from the key to the slot is really, really efficient. And in principle, this you cannot do without slightly expanding the size of the table, but we will show that we can build, in fact, a table of size that is linear in n. I forget exactly the bound. I think it's something like 10n. And of course, these are examples are not optimized. I'm sure you can squeeze it way below 10n, but this is to give you a good idea about the method, how it is done. So you want to produce a static hash table that is completely collision-free and extremely fast to compute. Now, the way how we are doing, and that's really important and interesting, the way will be randomized, but the hash functions and table will not be random, will not be randomized. So only the procedure of producing the hash functions, the hash function, will be done by trial and error. But a clever trial and error. So what do you think if you are doing something by trial and error? When do you have a good chance of succeeding? What should it be the case for the probability of consecutive failures? The probability to fail, right, has to be such that failing repetitively is very unlikely. So there is a small probability that failing in each attempt, that you will fail after, say, n many attempts. So notice here, the hash table will be non-random, but the procedure to get it is, in fact, randomized. So how do we do that? Well, it's pretty tricky construction, and we will need a little bit of mathematics to do it. This Markov inequality is bread and butter in algorithm, randomized algorithm design. And it's an extremely simple theorem, but that is really extraordinarily useful. What does it say? It says something very simple. If X is a random variable that cannot take negative values, so if the value of X is either zero or positive, right? Sorry? Oh, shoot, you are right. This is a mistake. It should be greater or equal than zero. Thanks for pointing out. So it is greater or equal than zero. I'll try to remember to correct it. And assume that T is any positive real number. What Markov inequality gives you is allows you to trade off expected value for probability. And the idea is if you want to have machinery to be able to conclude as follows, that if the expected number of your random variable, expected value is small, you want to conclude then large values are very unlikely. So you want to pass from, you want to kind of, from the fact that the expected value is small, you want to be able to conclude, which is kind of logical if X is non-negative, that then if the expected value is small, then the probability that you will take a large value must be also small. And this is an exact estimate. And all what is assumed is that X is non-negative and that the variable has expectation, right? Not all variables have a finite expectation. So, but we want to make sure that the first moment is in fact finite. So all what you know nothing about the probability distribution of x, only that x is non-negative and that it has an expected value e of x. Then Markov tells you probability, say that x is bigger than 1,000, in smaller than the expected value of x divided by 1,000. So larger you make t, right, less and less you are likely to exceed in each individual run, right, and each after each realization that your value will be bigger than t. And the proof is, of course, trivial. How do we, this is for the discrete case, right? For continuous case, essentially what you do is just replace summation with integration with respect to probability density. So what is the expected value of x? Well, this is the sum of the product of all values times probability to have this value. Well, because your variable takes only positive values, if I restrict the summation only to values that are bigger than t, I'll get smaller or equal value because I'm throwing away the contribution of all values v that are smaller than t, right? This is clearly true inequality. And now, what do we know? We know that v is bigger than t. So if I replace v by t, of course, the sum will only drop, will be smaller or equal. Now I can take out t in front of the sum. And what is the sum of all probabilities that x is equal to v when v is bigger than t? Well, that's exactly the probability that x is bigger or equal than t. And now if you divide both sides by t, you get the Markov inequality. I guess we are running out of time and I don't want to rush the construction. Please read this because it's going to get trickier and trickier, but it's not a rocket science. Okay, so please do yourself a favor because nowadays more and more randomized algorithms come into play in